I don't know why I always feel like I have to grunt when you call my name. I guess it's because it's like a wrestling call. It just has to happen.
The gruntings must be done.
I guess so. Okay.
Hello, Internet. It's that time again. One more time for the OOTPC. This time we are engaging in an episodic nature of number 008. That made zero sense what I just said.
It happens.
I am the Game Mage, and I am joined virtually by telepresence through tubes, data, zeros, ones, lots and lots of zeros and ones firing at our faces and our ears. That man, all those zeros and ones, is Mike the Hammer K. Kladzinski. How are you doing tonight, Mike?
I'm super. You know, that's the first time I've ever thought about that. Like, all these zeros and ones just flying into my ear holes and my eye holes.
Well, I guess technically, it's not zeros when it flies into our ears and eyes, because it becomes like waves again.
This is true. This is true.
So it's just like vibrations and emissions of photons, but...
Precisely.
Hey, this isn't a science podcast. What the heck's going on here? This is the OOTPC. We talk about video games and junk on this thing, so... and also, we're a band, and we talk about that kind of stuff.
Occasionally, we talk about music.
So speaking of being a band, is there anything regarding the band stuff that we want to update on?
Things are happening with something that's unannounced at this point in time.
That's true. Well, there's actually some motion and some really cool stuff happening. I'm getting my Jimmy's tickled.
Yes, Jimmy's are being tickled.
That sounds so bad.
So yeah, that.
I didn't want to say rustled because I didn't want to communicate that I was being upset.
Yes, I see what you've done there. I support this terminology. So yeah, that. I've actually started digging back into some LSDJ. So,
dude.
Yep. So that's might be delivered to your ear holes sometime in the next 3 or 4 years. We'll see.
I'll mark my calendar.
Right. No release date on that just yet, but yeah, at this point, it's been quite a while. So for those of you who don't know, and we'll just start at the beginning. So LSDJ is a, what do you call it? Like,
well, first we should say it's an acronym for Little Sound DJ, and it's not a drug.
Yes, my bad. Yeah. So we are not on drugs. Some may argue that, but we're not on drugs.
Yeah. That's beside the point.
But it's basically some software that you run on a Nintendo Game Boy, and you can program chiptunes music. And
it's a GUI interface to manipulate the sound chip on a Game Boy.
Yes, that. Yeah, so it's...
Oh, man, I just said GUI interface. That's redundant.
GUI interface.
Go ahead.
So, yeah, that is a thing. It's kind of interesting to get into at first. Once you get the hang of it, then you're able to do things much quicker. Then it becomes more of like a sound design kind of thing, because you literally have just complete control over these sounds. You know, if you can glitch it to happen, it'll happen. So you just got to kind of figure that kind of stuff out. So yeah, I've been diving back into some of that. That's very interesting to get back into after not having done that for like a year.
Yeah, the thing about LSDJ that's like really intimidating to me is just like you said, the design aspect of it.
Yeah.
Like the programming of the music, I mean, it's just like a tracker. So, I mean, you know, if for those of you who don't know, like a tracker, think about like you have X number of columns, and the way that it works is like each column represents one beat in the music, and then you hit play and it starts just scrolling down the columns you know, down rows at the tempo that you specify for the song. So each cell, as it were, if you think about it like a spreadsheet, each cell is one instrument playing or not playing on that specific beat. That aspect of it's actually pretty straightforward to get your head around. For me, the overwhelming part is creating and designing the actual sounds that those instruments make.
Because that's definitely the trick.
Yeah, like Mike's saying, there's tons and tons and tons of options, but I always find it challenging to match what I'm hearing in my head versus what the Game Boy's actually doing. So I think the people who are really good at doing, you know, using LSDJ to write music are the ones who are best at designing sounds.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. There's so much freedom in that department, especially designing just synth sounds, and then also turning a synth sound into some kind of drum sound is another thing that's crazy. But yeah, I mean, as with anything, the more you do it, the more comfortable you get, and the quicker you can be. So yeah, that's a thing.
Sweet. Yeah, that's something that's got me really excited. I had no idea that you were... I knew you had, for a long time, wanted to jump back into that, but I didn't know that you actually were DJing the LSs.
Yes. I've been kind of splitting my time with some of the stuff that we're doing that's unannounced and LSDJ stuff, so yeah.
I think that's quite appropriate, because for those of you who haven't heard some of what Mike's been able to do with LSDJ before... I guess the only way to find this publicly is on our Vine. Like, so if you go to vine.co/orderoftier, which actually you shouldn't go there, but if for somehow you happen to and go back to like our first actual original Vine that we put up,
yes,
it was just me holding a Game Boy playing the section from our song "Come to Life" that Mike had done on LSDJ, and it's, ladies and gentlemen, it's legit.
Yeah, that was a lot of work over the span of like a year, just randomly jumping back into it and getting at it. And that's why I never really got very quick at it. It's because like I'd get really into it and then be like, okay, sweet, and then I get distracted and go do something else, and I come back to it, and then I'm not as good at it, and then I have to, you know, develop the skill again, and it's just.
Yeah, but you go through that cycle enough, and then eventually you just know it, and then you come back, and you're like, okay, let me just pick up where I was.
Yeah, I will say that this time I was able to pick it up much quicker than I thought I was, so. And actually, I saw that, I was looking through our Vine account, which you should never do. I was in some deep, dark realm, some corner of the internet, and I found our Vine, and and I watched that video, and I was like, man, I'm such a boob, I need to do something here, so.
For real, it's super sweet, so... I'm definitely looking forward to see what comes out of that, because I would love to get into LSDJ, but I've just, I don't know. It's a time investment for sure, no doubt about it.
There is a learning curve.
I think that's pretty much all we have to say in the realm of band news. It sounds like maybe not a lot, but some of the things that are going on in the background are some pretty significant things that I'm like extremely stoked about, and I've been wanting to do for years at this point. One thing of band news that we've never really talked about much, you and I, Mike, definitely never talked on the podcast, but just in general, this coming January 2016, it will have been 10 years that we've been a band.
Holy motherless.
Isn't that ridiculous?
That's a thing. Wow.
Yeah, I mean, before that...
we've made some serious tunes.
Oh, yeah. Like, before that, there was a previous band that I was a part of at one point, and then I left, and you guys kept going, and then that band kind of morphed or ended in Order of Tier began with a lot of the same people, and that was in when I came back to start playing with you guys in January 2006.
Mm. Wow.
It's ridiculous. 10 stinking years. I really wanted to do something huge for that, but I don't think we got enough time between now and then.
Well, maybe we can think of something not so huge, but seemingly huge.
Or something that's just cool to do. I think we should mark the occasion in some way.
I support this.
All right, on to the next topic. Let's do a little bit of what we're playing. How about you, Mike? What are you playing these days?
Well, so this past weekend, I beat Transformers Devastation.
Oh, sweet.
The last hour of that is, it's quite the epicness. The game ends, so, it's one of those games where, you know, you start playing it and then it is just like the most magical thing for a Transformers fan, the most magical thing you've ever seen, because it feels like you are in a G1 cartoon or something. And then, you know, at some point that magic kind of wears off. But it's still a great game. So it's still fun. The dialogue is still interesting.
You just get used to it, I guess.
Yeah. And the thing that was interesting to me is there have been a lot of times, like in some of the recent movies, in some of the recent games, where they have quoted stuff from the movie, the original movie. Those quotes that have been drilled into the ground over and over and over again. And it always feels like it's extremely tacked on. I mean, you know, it's, don't get me wrong, you know, like in the first Bayformers movie, when they said some of those things, it was like, oh, that's cool that they're acknowledging that that's a thing. But still, it feels kind of tacked on, like it's just kind of there. In this game, it feels more inspired by some of those things that they said. So it actually feels like part of the dialogue, not just something that was tacked on to get a rise out of you if you, you know, if you liked that movie.
It was tastefully done, in other words.
Exactly. I mean, it definitely gets hard as all the ball sacks. Like, it is just... But the cool thing about it is just, as you progress through the game, you really have to use most every mechanic available to you to beat it. Mm. Whereas, like, in Bayonetta, you know, you have the witch time thing, and that's like, that's your big thing. That's how you get through the game. If you can't do that, then, you know, you need to play a different game.
Right.
In this, it's really a combination of that as well as being able to transform and do something. And then I previously said when I initially talked about the game that the shooting aspect of it wasn't quite up to what you would think it would be for a game like that. Mm-hmm. But as you progress through it and you upgrade your character, which is another necessity, you get like these credit things and you can upgrade different stats about your character, whoever you choose to play as. I played as Wheeljack just because he was the most balanced as far as range and melee. So, how did I get on that tangent? there were many times where in a battle I would find myself doing some kind of melee thing and then knocking the dude down and then transforming and then going away really quick. And then I'm shooting at them as I'm doing this whole thing, curving back around. And then you go at them. And then there's this move you can do where you ram into them and then you transform and then you attack them. And then you do like the witch time thing and then like rinse and repeat. So it's just coming up with little strategies like that is really cool. It's definitely different than any, kind of beat 'em up game like that I've ever played, as far as just the way you play it.
A couple extra mechanics in there.
Yeah, so you really got to learn how to use all of them. So I really appreciated that, and it feels like you were in a G1 cartoon from the beginning to the very end.
So are you saying there's like a cliffhanger at the end?
There is something that happens at the end that leads me to believe there will be either DLC for this or another one. So that's very nice.
That's cool.
That would be very much welcome.
Can imagine.
And then of course, you know, for the credits, you got some cheesy 80s kind of song.
That's awesome.
So yeah.
Sweet.
And then, the game mage over there gave me Until Dawn for my birthday, which is this month. So I have not started playing that yet, but that is quite literally been bumped up to the next thing. Yes.
So I'm we're audio only here, but we're actually doing this over a Hangout, and I'm actually holding up my own copy of Until Dawn to show my, I actually ordered two when I got his, because this game was the reason I wanted to get it. Well, first, PT was the reason I wanted to get a PS4, and then Until Dawn. I figured that I would just preempt because I knew that I was going to be getting a PS4 soon. Which, yeah. I guess that's a segue into... So today, November 10th, 2015, this is the day that Fallout 4 was released.
Yes.
to the delight of many people. But Best Buy put on this sale where you could get a couple different bundles of the PS4 plus Fallout 4 for $350, which is like how much it really normally costs for those bundles of the PS4. And not to be outdone, GameStop did the same thing, although they only restricted it to one specific bundle, the Nathan Drake collection bundle. And so I had to buy a PS4. I mean, it's like, I was going to get one anyway, just because there's lots of games on the PS4 that I want to play. I like PlayStation stuff. I'm not like a PlayStation fanboy. I'm not like Death to Microsoft kind of PlayStation fanboy, but if I had to choose, like, ignoring Nintendo, if I had to choose sides in the console wars, quote-unquote, that are going on right now, I mean, much of a war, not really, but I definitely come up on the PlayStation side. Yeah. And strangely enough, that's mostly just because of the controller. Like, I mean, I've held an Xbox One controller, like, once. I don't remember much about it, but, and I mean, the 360 controller is okay, but the PlayStation controllers always felt way better to me. And I think I've talked about this before, but I just really like the PlayStation controller. Anyway, all that to say that I ended up picking up the PS4 because, you know, free Fallout 4, how can you go wrong?
Yep.
So I should be getting that sometime.
Yeah, you'll have to let me know how that is. That's on my list of games to get, but probably not going to be getting it for another couple of months or so. We'll see.
I didn't plan on it. You know me in games like that. I would have waited till it was like $20 or something to get it. Like Skyrim, I got that when it was two DLCs were like $5 on Steam.
Yep.
And best $5 I've ever spent. but yeah, it's just, I don't know. I got sucked into the hype, I guess. And the thing is, like, I'm not like a huge Fallout fan or anything. I think the concept's awesome, right? I think the idea of the world's really cool. I've played about an hour into Fallout 3, which I know that's sacrilege to say when I say I'm a gamer. The thing that really turned me off about Fallout 3 was just, like, everything was brown. Like, everything was brown.
Yeah.
But it looks like that's not the case in Fallout 4. And I've actually played more of the original Fallout than I have any other Fallout game, in which I do like the original Fallout. It's cool. It's difficult, and that's part of why I like it, I guess. But
I actually haven't played. I've only played 3.
I don't know if I can suggest the original one, other than to say, if you like, you know, like strategy RPGs, like Final Fantasy Tactics, like those types of games.
Yeah.
You'd probably want to play it. But if you've like never played those kinds of games, or you don't know what those kinds of games are really about or like, I would say if you love the Fallout universe, play it. Or if you really, really want to know more about it, play it. But otherwise, it's just not worth it.
Yeah.
Or if you like another one, a good example, well, I won't say good, but if you liked any of the XCOM games, or like the newer one, like XCOM Enemy Unknown, I think there may be even a newer one than that, but if you like those kind of like team-based strategy games, like tactical strategy games, you'd probably be okay with Fallout. So
that's cool.
I don't know if you've played any of those games either, but
no, I know that the style of game you're talking about. Yeah. That's probably my least favorite kind of RPG, but
it's intense because like it's extremely detail oriented, right? That was one of that's one of the cool things I think that Fallout did do when it went 3D was that it kind of it opened it up to a vastly larger audience by, you know, obviously in combat in those old games like that you're restricted to where you can move in combat.
Yeah.
And now, I mean, it makes sense in one way of thinking, but it doesn't make sense in another way of thinking. Of course, you can just run around. When you have turn-based everything, that's not realistic. But, like, I'm a huge, well, not anymore, I won't but say, but when I was in high school, I was a really big tabletop gaming guy. Mm-hmm. Like, I love D&D, and, you know, me and my friends, we would play D&D, like, every Friday. We would order a bunch of pizzas, get a bunch of, like, not Mountain Dew, but, like, off-brand Mountain Dew from Kroger, and just go at it for, like, you know, hours, man. So, you know, I love that whole, you know, turn-based, old-school role-playing feel.
Yeah.
But if you're not into that, and, like, you haven't really thought about gaming in that way, it's hard to get into. It's a tough nut to crack.
Yeah.
So, anyway, I'm hoping Fallout 4 is going to be as good as everybody expects it to be, and all the reviews have said that it is. Mm-hmm. I don't know why it wouldn't be. I just hope it looks nicer than Fallout 3 did.
Right. Yeah, I probably played Fallout 3 for like maybe 7 hours or something like that. And I really liked it. And then all of a sudden it started reminding me of Oblivion. And then I started getting really tired of it. And I was like, okay. I just can't.
Was it like were the missions or quests or whatever Oblivion, where you do the same thing over and over and over and over?
I think that's what it was. I don't really know. Honestly, I can't really remember. I just remember literally feeling like I was playing Oblivion, and I was like, oh, I just can't.
Yeah.
I heard Fallout New Vegas was really good, but it was really broken.
Well, I think it was, well, my understanding of that, yes, I heard that too. My understanding is that it was extremely broken at launch.
Yeah.
But they eventually fixed it. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I never played it, but.
Yeah, people say it's really good. That's what I hear about that. Because, like, I've looked a lot into the series with the pending release of Fallout 4. Hype train and whatnot, but, I mean, I'm excited to play it. I mean, of course, that's what caused me to go ahead and pick up a PS4, because, you know, a game that, you know, I was probably going to wait to go to $20, well, it'll be, you know, another couple years before it's at that point.
Yeah.
I definitely will have a PS4 by then. You know, I could play it on PC, but, I don't know. I'm starting to become more of a console gamer, put it that way. Although... Man. I say that, but, well, anyway, go ahead.
Man, I don't know. Like, recently, games that have come out on Xbox One, PS4, and PC, like, the PC version has is consistently broken for all these different games. And I don't know what is the deal with it. Like, they're
just pushing it up. I think they spend a lot of the optimization cycles that they have on console, because it's very... It's a known target, right?
Yeah.
And PC is like, well, yeah, people have, you know, good rigs. And I think, and it's not always just like the specs are too low on PC that caused the brokenness. But I think that when they do their testing, it's mainly on high-end rigs. And I think that plays into it, at least to some degree, in their QA process. Or it could just be, you know, sloppy QA on the PC side.
Yeah. I mean, I don't... What game was it that came out last week or something? Last week or the week before? It was some fairly...
Black Ops 3? Well,
that's what it was. Yeah, that's what it was. What was it?
Okay.
Apparently, the PC version, if you had an i5 processor, it wouldn't work.
Like any i5 or like the newest generation?
I just saw i5.
Wow.
So I don't know what the deal with that was. And also, like, the newest Batman game.
That was like, a travesty.
Yeah, that game came out and did not freaking... The PC version did not work at all.
Yeah, like, they're giving everybody their money back at the end of the year. Like, that bad didn't work.
And they're like, yeah, this actually probably needs a couple more months in the hopper, so,
Yeah. I don't know how anybody's ever going to want to buy that on PC at this point.
Yeah.
Like... I'm surprised they're not just, like, aborting the PC launch and be like, oh, we'll give you your money back. We're just not even going to bring it out on PC.
Right.
But, yeah. I don't really understand that either. That's a good point. But here's the thing, though. It's one of those trade-offs, too, because... and I guess to go into a little bit of what I'm playing, it's a trade-off because you can also get really, really awesome-looking performing games... you know, 60 FPS, you know, extremely high resolution textures, all that kind of stuff loaded up into memory where you couldn't do that on the console.
Yeah.
Because, like, well, I mean, this isn't the greatest example of that, but this is an example. Right now I'm playing through Resident Evil HD Remaster and playing it at 60 frames a second. And that is making me fall in love with Resident Evil all over again, because it's just so beautiful. And yeah. I just love how it looks and all the detailing. Like, obviously, I'm used to the really crappy graphics of the original Resident Evil. I never really played the remake other than just for, you know, a few minutes. And so, like, just seeing that mansion with that kind of detail, that high of resolution textures, just the 60 FPS is just nuts, dude. It looks, and it works so well because I have a pretty decent machine. My graphics card's like, I don't know, a couple years old at this point, or a year and a half, something like that. But it was like basically top of the line back then, or more or less top of the line. And so, you know, I can max out any game that I want to play right now. Now, I haven't bought a brand new game within the past 6 months, but I mean, Resident Evil was released, in January? So, I don't know. I love it. But it's a double-edged sword. So, you know, if you get a good release on PC, it's worth having a good PC to play it.
Yeah.
But the problem is it's not consistent. That's the thing that I'm really running into. And it's like, on a console, okay, maybe it's not as great looking. Maybe you're frame locked at 30 frames per second. But generally, you're going to have a more consistent experience.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's always been my thing with console versus PC. Also, the fact that you can just put a game in and play it. Oh, wait! Never mind about that one.
No, you can't do that anymore. Yeah, I fully expect to have to sit through a couple hours when I turn on Fallout 4. I almost said 3. 4 for the first time.
Yeah,
I definitely would have to sit a couple hours or a little while for Fallout 3.
And I'm definitely more of a controller kind of guy. I'd much rather, even though, you know...
See, I'm not. That's what's so hard for me. Is like, yeah. I'm definitely a keyboard mouse guy. Now I'm playing Resident Evil with a controller because that game's just made for a controller.
Yeah. I don't know. I just can't. After sitting at a desk all day long, the last thing I want to do is sit there with a keyboard and a mouse in my hands. I'd much rather sit on a couch.
Absolutely. That's why I am becoming more of a console guy, because that is literally what is driving me there, because I love using a keyboard, I love using a mouse, I love the precision, I love, you know, having everything, all the controls, like, right at fingertips, but, yeah it's like, I can't sit behind a keyboard for 100 hours a week, 120 hours a week, that's just...
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, so that's part of what I'm playing is, like I said, Resident Evil HD Remaster. I'm also still playing through Parasite Eve. That game's a lot of fun, dude. I know you have a long list of games you need to play, but I would say maybe tack that one on there. Let me wait till I get to the end before I say definitely okay. Do that, because at this point, you know, I understand most of the game's mechanics, or all the game's mechanics. They're not that complicated. It's mainly just, is the story worth it?
Yeah.
Right now, the story, it's not bad. I know kind of where it's going, but it's like, it's one of those things where, like, ooh, let's be mysterious and cryptic and, right. You know, keep pushing until you find more. But it's not like one of those things where, like, you can really, it's pretty linear, put it that way.
Yeah.
It's much more linear than most role-playing games.
Mm.
Oh, man. Okay, I got to tell you about this. Five Strike Nights me. At Freddy's. Five Nights at Freddy's. Still playing that. I'm on night 4.
Uh-huh.
And not beaten night 4 yet, mm-hmm. obviously, because I'm still on night 4. I played it, like, 3 times in a row. Like, so I was recording this for the YouTube channel, and, dude, I don't know what I'm doing wrong, but, like, every time when it gets to be about 3 a.m., like, I'm checking both sides. I'm hearing, like, the pattering of feet, and then I'm checking to make sure, you know, things aren't around and stuff. And then I'll bring up the cameras to take a look at Foxy on a stage, and then bring it down, and then right there, get me. And it's like, I don't know what you're supposed to do to... Like, I mean, like, it, like, literally gets me.
Yeah.
And, like, now I don't even want to look at the camera, but you have to, because Foxy just runs out.
Right.
It's like, dude, like, for real, 12 a.m., Foxy ran down to me the second time I was playing it. Luckily, man. I've never been, like, killed by Foxy or whatever. I I see when he's not on stage and I just like door immediately, but
dude, the first time he darted out for me, he got me and I thought I wet myself. Yeah.
That game is trying to give me a heart attack.
It was the second night too. It was the first time I played the second night. It was like,
oh, but you never watched any playthroughs or anything, right?
No. Okay. It was like maybe 3 or 4 a.m. or something like that.
Yeah. 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 If you're not like always watching that camera, dude. Oh, totally.
And I glanced over there at that camera and then, you know, he wasn't there. I was like, well, that's interesting. And then I looked at the hallway, and as I looked at the hallway, he was darting down the hallway, and I was like, and then I went back, and then when I, you know, went back, he's like, rah!
Yeah.
And I was like, well, frig, I'm dead.
Yeah.
I just clipped the crap out of the microphone. My bad.
That's all right. I mean, it happens. We're talking about Five Nights at Freddy's, what do you expect? That game's probably single-handedly responsible for most of the audio clips on the internet these days.
Exactly.
But yeah, I mean, it's a fun game. It's, I don't know how to describe how I feel about the game. I'm glad I'm playing it. I'll put it that way. It's not a creepy game in any sort of, I mean, like the concept, when you think about the concept or you first hear it, you're like, wow, that's pretty creepy.
Yeah.
But then like when you watch a lot of playthroughs and you've been playing it, it doesn't feel creepy. Cause I mean, it's just, it's one of those things, like, you know when people do game development, and I don't know where I saw this once. It's some studio that was saying whenever they start on a new game, you know, most studios, when they start developing prototypes and whatnot, they have no graphical assets. So they just have, like, boxes and stuff to represent characters and, you know, just, like, white boxes and black walls, stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, they said that if the game's not fun playing it like that, then it's not really worth making the game, because at that point you're just selling the art assets. You're not selling the game, right? You're just dressing up something that's not fun. And so when I'm playing Five Nights at Freddy's, it feels like the opposite way. I feel like I there's all these graphics here and stuff, but I'm just playing the game where it's just boxes. Right, there's nothing to it, because I know all the entities, I know what's going on, and I know there's a measure of randomness in everything, and I'm just trying to manage that randomness in the using the tools that are given to me.
Right.
So knowing that, how do I say this without sounding disrespectful of the game, because I like the game, but I feel like I'm not experiencing the atmosphere of the game when I'm playing it, other than I feel like I'm experiencing my own emotions only, my anxiety playing the game, right? And my apprehension.
Yeah.
And it's not, it's dread, but it's not dread in a, I don't know how to handle this sort of way. That's what I really like about the Silent Hill games, is they try to give you that sense of dread without any means to deal with it, especially PT. Oh my goodness. PT really does that, because you're almost completely disempowered.
Yeah.
But Five Nights at Freddy's kind of flips that, where it gives you that sense of dread because you know you're going to get scared, but you have all the tools at your disposal to manage it. So having those tools makes it seem less scary in that sense.
Right. Yeah.
And I know there are a lot of people that are on this whole thing about, oh, Five Nights at Freddy's is just a hype train, and there's like, it's not a scary game at all. And I disagree with that, because I think it is and can be a scary game. It's just, it's not the kind of scary game that you imagine it to be when you think about it when you're playing it. So
yeah, once you experience it, it's definitely a much different world than when you hear about it.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, that's cool. I like I said, I think it's a cool game. It's a very cool concept. Like the whole series art, and I know I don't want to spoil anything for you, because I know you've not really looked much into it beyond what you've played of the first game.
Yeah.
But I hope this isn't much of a spoiler for you, but there is variety in the gameplay. So in the 2 through 4, it's not just you don't play it exactly the way you play 1, although there are many similar things. But I think all the games are cool in their own right. They have enough variation in how they're presented, how you play them, to warrant them being separate games, especially at the price point. They're not expensive games.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't want to get on this train that people are starting up of, you know, really bashing Five Nights at Freddy's and like, oh, hype, it's just hype and it's not a good game and all that. No, it's, if it wasn't a good game, people wouldn't buy it if they weren't interested in playing it.
Exactly.
There would be people saying, don't buy this game, it's stupid. Now, if you don't like the game or if it's not for you, I totally understand that. But don't try to, you know, lambast this game just because you think it's been overhyped by the internet. Maybe it has, but there are plenty of games, Duke Nukem Forever, that have been completely, completely overhyped and have not lived up to a single, you know, iota of that hype.
Dude, that's a great, you know, $2 game.
Oh, yeah.
Although absolutely. I saw it for $3.95 the other day, and I was like, overpriced.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, especially when you know you can get it for $2.
Right.
I thought you were talking about Five Nights at Freddy's, and I was like, it's a little more than $2, and I realized you're talking about Duke Nukem Forever.
Maybe.
But no, it's cool. But yeah, and I don't want to sing the praises of the game too highly, right? I think it's a good game for the price. I think it's appropriately priced. I think if the premise interests you, go play the game. Go play the first one. If you enjoy that, continue with the series. That's where I'll leave it at. So
yeah.
Circling that back around to my experience playing the game and not on some, you know, soapbox tangent about the environment around the game. It's a good game. I want to finish it, but I can only play that game in short spurts like that. Like, I didn't even get... I want to have one video where I finish each night. And so since I didn't finish the fourth night in one video, I'm trying to split it into two recording sessions. I'm hoping the next time I'll be able to beat it. Yeah. But it's one of those games that I've got to psych myself up to play. Because this is what I do like about the game. And I think it's kind of a meta game. And I don't know... Surely somebody's talked about this. But this is why I appreciate and respect the game. Because I don't know if... Scott Cawthorn or something like that. Whoever made it. I don't know if he intended this. I hope that he did, because then he's a genius if he did. But him creating this game has created this whole meta game where you don't want to play the game. Thinking about playing the game itself makes you creeped out and scared and anxious. And that's... So there are horror games, you know, that do that. PT does that, I think, to a lot of people.
Yeah.
To me, to a degree, for sure. At the beginning, for sure.
Oh, definitely. The first time I played it, I had to really psych myself up to play it.
But here's the thing. Five Nights at Freddy's is a game that you never get over that with.
Yep.
Right? Because, like, PT, okay, yeah, you can remember all the things that happen and more or less know where the scares are going to be and what the creepiness is.
Yeah.
But Five Nights at Freddy's... It's random. It's always random. And so I think that apprehension will always be there to play that game. And I think that's... If he thought about that in designing the game, that man's a genius. And I think regardless, he deserves the money he's getting for that game, like in general. Like that's awesome. But I think that if he actually intentionally planned that, man, my hat's off to him, because that's some pretty stellar... game design when you
your game definitely
affects somebody outside of the game.
And now whenever I drive by Chuck E. Cheese's, that's all I think about.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
Like, do those dudes wander around in there at night?
I wonder now how many like Chuck E. Cheese's get phone calls like, do you guys have like a night security guard position?
Of course we do.
Yeah.
You gotta let those suckers walk around at night.
Right.
Don't want them servos locking up.
No, not at all, man. It gets rusty, and they get ornery if you try to get in there and service them. So let them take care of that themselves. So Five Nights at Freddy's, that's definitely something I'm playing. The other thing I wanted to talk about, and I didn't mean to speak so long about the other things. I've been playing, and I don't know if you saw me tweeting about this, Mike, but I've been playing Resident Evil 2 a good bit. The past few days, meaning literally the past few days, Saturday, Sunday, and yesterday. I don't know what caused me to want to do this, but Saturday evening, I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to mess around with my... I have a Twitch now. For better or worse. I think Twitch is good. I didn't mean that from the platform. I meant that more from the... I don't know if I should be engaging in said activities, but...
Right.
By the way, twitch.tv.com? twitch.tv/the_game_mage. But I was like, you know what? I'm going to just kind of mess around and test and see if my setups, you know, set up any kind of good for this. Spoilers, it wasn't for streaming. And I was like, I'm going to play some Resident Evil 2. I haven't played that in a long, long time. So, you know, I've got that on my PlayStation 3. And so I hooked everything up and I did a couple tests and things looked okay. And then so I started streaming. The audio came out terrible on that first one. But anyway, so I started and I was playing as Leon in the A game, and I've never beaten it as Leon in the A game. And I was playing it on easy, and so I was like, well, I was just going to do it just to mess around anyway, so why not just do easy?
Yeah.
And then I got to the police station, which is one of the early things you do in the game. Well, it's the first thing you have to do. You have to get to the police station. Started playing. I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to play until I die once. I'm not going to save. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to play until I die once. And then I kept playing. I wasn't dying. Kept playing. Wasn't dying. Kept playing. I'm like, man, I don't know if I'm going to die here. And I get about, in retrospect, it was over or about halfway through the game. Halfway through the game. And it was like 1:30 or something like that. And I'm like, man, I got to go to bed. And so like I saved once. And I thought, well, maybe I'll pick this up next week or something. And then the next day, I got possessed again. I'm like, I'm going to keep playing.
Yeah.
And I ended up beating the game. Like, it took me a total of just under 4 hours, like, the game time to beat it. And I did all that on the stream, and so I exported that and put that on my channel. And then last night, I was like, you know what? That was actually... not too bad. I did it in less than 4 hours, and I hadn't played that game in forever, and so I had to kind of relearn some of the puzzles.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know what? I kind of know it now. Let me try it again. So I'm like, I'm going to play it on normal this time, and I'm going to do the same thing. I'm just not going to stop, I'm not going to save, I'm just going to play until I die. And then played it on normal mode. So I started playing, and I'm like, man, I'm doing all right here. Ended up beating the game in... 2 hours and 23 seconds. I was really upset because I wanted to beat it in under 2 hours, and I would have had I not... I played through it, and what you can do, the way that this game works is, when you play, there are two characters, Leon and Claire, and they both have what's called their A scenario and B scenario. And so, at the beginning of the game, you're together, and you get split up. And so if you play Leon's A scenario... while you're doing that, Claire's going through the B scenario.
Yeah.
And when you beat Leon's A scenario, you can then save your game and start Claire's B scenario and play that. And then the other way around, if you do Claire's A scenario, you can play Leon's B scenario.
Yeah.
So, you do things in the A scenario, and they affect the B scenario. So, like, items, if you take an item in a certain place, then it's not going to be there in the B scenario.
Okay, or, that's cool.
And then there's, like, secrets that you can unlock that you have to do... half of it in the A scenario and half of it in the B scenario. So one of them that I've never done before, I did the first half in the A scenario so that I could unlock it in the B scenario.
Uh-huh.
And if I hadn't done that, it would have been like, you know, an hour, 55 minutes or something.
Mm.
It's like, I was really kicking myself after that. But I got A rank. I've never gotten above C rank before.
Mm.
So that was awesome. Zero saves, use zero first aid sprays. Man, I was super proud of that.
that's super pro mode there.
Here's what's funny. I mean, it is and it isn't, because like world record time is like an hour 7 minutes or something like that, or an hour 8 minutes.
Uh-huh.
So it's not that pro, because like I actually stopped to kill some of the zombies in key places because it would be easier, because you have to like come back through.
Uh-huh.
Like the pros, they just run and dodge everything. They don't like they only kill like the last enemy in the game.
Mm.
And yeah, it's pretty crazy. But yeah, I actually watched a speed run of it the other day too, and that's kind of what prompted me to want to try it. But what's really funny, like I wasn't gonna do a zero save run because I'm too paranoid for that, because like normally my saves are like 30 or something like that in the game. Like I just don't want to lose progress. But I was like, okay, I'm going to play up until the last big section of the game, and I'm going to you can save at the beginning of that. Mm-hmm. And I got there, and I was like, you know what? The first few things in this part of it, I know how to do, and there's like no real enemies for it, so I'm just going to go ahead and do it. And so I did that, and then I'm like, well, the next part, there's only like two enemies you have to dodge, and even if I don't dodge them and they like attack me, I'm not going to die. So I'm just going to go ahead and do it. I just kept doing that kind of thing for a while. And then I'm like, I'm almost at the final boss here. I'm just going to save right before the final boss. That's all. That's the only save, right before the final boss. That way, if he kills me, I didn't lose the whole game. And right. I can just, you know, pick up and beat him.
Oh, man.
And then the way that this game works is you have to have ink ribbons and you save at typewriters. So yeah. I got there and I was like, wait a second. I've not been saving this whole game and I didn't pick up any ink ribbons. And I get to the typewriter. Oh. Sometimes the typewriters have an ink ribbon in front of it. The last one doesn't. And I'm like, I can't even save, even though I want to. I had to stop, and I'm like, okay, we're going to do this, Jordan. Let's do it. I went in, and I beat him, and I only had to use one healing item in the final fight. And it Man. Was like, I wish I had recorded that. Because I wasn't streaming it. I was just playing it.
Oh, you didn't record this.
Exactly. That's why I took the picture of my screen with my cell phone and gotcha. Tweeted it to have proof. Like, look, I actually did this. So, the cool thing, though, is I actually had to backtrack a few times. So I know that I can beat the game in under 2 hours. I could probably get it down to 145 playing it kind of the way that I did. But there's no way it's going to be faster than that unless I try to do like as speedrunners call them, the strats to dodge all the zombies and not stop killing. Of course, that's what they call them. Yeah, twice in the past 3 days, I've beaten Leon's A campaign, and I've never done that before in my life. And so I was like, "Wow, I feel awesome." I feel even better that the faster run of the two was when I was playing on normal and not easy.
Yeah.
But the only real difference, I think, in normal and easy is that, like, in easy, you start with more handgun bullets, like a lot more, like 100 more or something like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, like in normal, you have like, there's 18 in the gun, and then there's like maybe 18 that you start with separately. It's over 100 extra that you start with.
Wow.
And like, there are these chests throughout the game that if you drop an item there, you can get it from any other chest in the game.
Uh-huh.
That has like 3 first aid sprays in it when you...
Okay.
When you first get to it in easy, so but other than that, I think it's all the same. So yeah, I mean, that was cool. I was really happy with that. So I'm gonna try to play through some more of those campaigns, like Claire B, and then Flip and do Claire A and Leon B, because I've never beaten all 4 of them. Uh-huh. I've only beaten Claire A and Leon B, but not the other way around.
That's pretty cool that they do that.
Yeah. And
especially when you do something that affects something else, that's pretty cool.
Most definitely, and you can really screw yourself over on the B campaign, because there's this one point where there's 2 items. There's a submachine gun, and then there's a pack, like a side pack. And, like, normally you have, what is it, I think 8 slots in your inventory? 6 or 8, I think it's 8, and the side pack gives you 2 more. And so if you pick up that side pack, though, you can't use it in the B campaign. But it's like you almost need it in both campaigns sometimes. Like, if you play the game like I normally play it, you need it. But if you play it like I played it last night, you don't. Yeah. You absolutely don't even... Like, 6 is more than enough storage spot. Well, I wouldn't say more than enough, but it's plenty.
Yeah.
There was, like, never a time in that run where I was like, man, I wish I had another slot. And normally in Resident Evil, I'm like, man, I wish I had, like, 10 more slots. So it's interesting when you start playing like optimized runs like that. This is the first game I've ever done anything like that in, and I totally understand why people become speedrunners, because it's like addictive to like play something and do it like way better than you've ever done it before. And like, oh man, I know I could do even better because I made this little mistake here. So if I go back and don't make that mistake. Anyway.
Yeah, that's pretty
If you can't
cool.
tell, I'm pretty excited about that, because like that's, Resident Evil 2 is one of my favorite games ever for sure. Definitely top 10, most definitely.
I really like those. Well, at least the first one's the only one I've played at this point in time.
Yeah.
But I really like how there are so many different things about that game that you can tell was just like really thought through. Like the saving mechanic. And I don't remember where I heard this, but apparently Japanese people, especially Japanese developed games, they, and if you've played a lot of Japanese games, you'd notice this. The saving mechanic is rarely just like a menu option. You always have to like do something or go somewhere specifically to save or something like that. They always try to make that like a part of the gameplay itself, is just saving the game.
Yeah. Don't want to interrupt the flow there.
Yeah. And when I saw the ink ribbon thing, I was like, wow, this is so Japanese.
I think it's one of the best, mechanics for saving in a game that I've ever come across. Yeah, I can't think of any others where it's like, oh, that's cool. Because like even in like Silent Hill, okay, so Silent Hill, the first one, it's a notepad, so it's like you're writing down notes, so yeah, that's pretty cool. And then the second one, it's just like this red square on the wall, and it's like you're looking into it, so it's like, I don't know if it's supposed to be symbolic of you like connecting with the town somehow. I'm mm-hmm. not sure. And then the third one, it's the same sort of thing. It's like the halo of the sun. It's like there's a cult in Silent Hill, and it's like one of their emblems. And it's the same thing. You look at it, and it, like, your head hurts or whatever, and then you can save the game. But I really like how in Resident Evil, it's like the two pieces. It's like you can't just go up to a typewriter and start typing.
Yeah.
You have to have the ink ribbon. Although I think in Resident Evil 4, it's still a typewriter, but you don't have to have the ink ribbon anymore. You can save at a typewriter. Mm. Which I guess makes a little more sense, because most typewriters are going to have an ink ribbon on it already, and you're not going to have to change it as soon as you get there. But I really appreciate the level of detail of having to have it. And it doesn't even create a barrier, because there's more than enough ink ribbons. Unless you're like me wanting to save 30 times in a game, there's plenty of ink ribbons in the game.
Yeah, I quickly found out my first time I played that game that there's some serious strategery involved in that game.
Well, the first one, there's way limited ink ribbons, actually. Uh-huh. You have to be much more careful about when you save. The second one, it's not like that. And the third one's definitely not like that either.
Yeah, like the first time I wasted one of those ink ribbons, I was like, wait a minute. Yeah. Effing A, I'm retarded. Okay.
Like everybody makes the mistake, I think, the first time, like, saving after the intro cutscene at the first typewriter right there at the stairs. It's like, no, don't do that. Don't ever do that.
Yeah, because I saved it, and then I did a bunch of stuff, and I came back and was like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
I see what they did here.
Yeah.
And it's funny, because growing up, when I first saw that game, I just thought, oh, you just run around killing zombies. That's cool. But there's so much more to it than that.
Yes, definitely. It's
way more.
Now, if you're talking about 4 or 5, and probably 6, I've not played 6, but it's definitely a lot more. You just go and mow them down. Yeah. But 1, 2, and 3, especially 1 and 2, and most especially 1, it's like, how can I not get entangled with all these zombies that are everywhere? And it's like, sometimes you just gotta kill them. You just can't not kill them. And, or you can, but you have to be a speedrunner to not.
Right. Yeah, I'm hoping. So, Until Dawn is the next game I'm gonna play.
Oh, yeah.
And then Silent Hill Shatter Memories.
Awesome.
And then hopefully we'll see. Jump back into Resident Evil after that. My goal is to have the first Resident Evil beaten before the second HD remake comes out.
Well, the second or 0?
I'm pretty sure it was 2.
Well, no, they're doing 2, but they're doing 0 before 2.
Which one should I play first?
It doesn't really matter. As long as
what you is 0 again?
0, so in 1, the two characters you can play as, Chris or Jill, they go to the area where the mansion is with a whole team.
Yeah.
But the only reason that their team goes in is another team had gone, they're the Bravo team, but the Alpha team? Or wait, maybe it's the other way around, whatever. The first team that went in, they lost radio contact with them, and so they don't know what's going on, so they send the team in, the second team, which is who you play as in the first one. Yeah. Resident Evil 0 follows a character who was on the first team, who got separated, and so it's
cool.
Takes place concurrently time-wise with the first game, but it doesn't really, well, if you need to play 1 before 0, but you don't need to play 2 before 0. Put it that way.
Okay, well, that's cool.
But really, whatever. I can't remember if Zero spoils anything about One. Because it's possible that you could play Zero before One, but it doesn't really matter. Either way, I do have a question for you.
Yes.
Because I don't want to speak and like really spoil stuff if we're ever talking about Resident Evil. How much do you know about the plot in Resident Evil, the first one?
Very little.
Okay. Do you know anything about the enemies at the end of the game or anything like that?
No. I have avoided all talk of that kind of stuff.
Good.
And done a pretty good job of it, actually.
Yeah. I mean, it's nothing like crazy spectacular. It's just one of those things where it could be spoiled if you've seen it.
Yeah, generally, if a really old game like that I have not played yet or beaten or whatever, I try to avoid. Once I hear somebody talking about it or see something, I'm like, nope, bye. Like Final Fantasy VII, I have not beaten that. And so anytime I see people discussing that, I'm like, okay, I'm going to just exit this way.
Oh, but surely you've had some of the ends of that spoiled for you.
Oh, I've had some things spoiled of that. Okay. So
yeah, one got spoiled for me, and I'm like, really? It didn't really bug me as much as I thought it would, because like I've probably put 20 plus hours into that game, starting it multiple different times. I've never gotten that far into it, I don't think, but maybe close, but not that far. Yeah. Anyway, so I don't love the game. I've played enough of the game to know I'm not like in love with the characters, and I'm not super in love with the world or anything like that. But having that spoiled didn't affect me as bad as I thought that it would.
Yeah.
Or not the whole game, but one of the big things that happens at the end of the game.
Yeah.
So. And yeah, people just talk about that SH now like it's like everybody knows, and it's like,
oh yeah, oh dude, I know. No. Very frequently have I been listening to a podcast and then the topic comes up and I'm like, deuces.
Yeah, exactly. Luckily I was able to play Final Fantasy VIII before any of that got spoiled for me, but and I mean maybe that's why no, that's not true. So, well, this is a topic for another time. Let's put on the list for another podcast, or maybe an Order More Tires, Final Fantasy VII versus Final Fantasy VIII. And I want to talk about that before I complete Final Fantasy VII, and then after I complete Final Fantasy VII.
All right.
Because I don't know if my perspective is going to change, but I want to put on record my perspective as it is now versus my perspective as it is afterwards. So.
Sweet.
So that means I need to get started playing Final Fantasy VII. Oh my goodness, so many games.
Yeah, I know. That's why I've just started a list, and if I ever get something that's a higher priority, it just goes up there at the top. Everything else gets shifted down, and some of those things just have been there for a year, and a half, 10 years. You know,
I gotta start rationing my time.
I'm probably going to wait to play Final Fantasy VII for the HD remake to come out, but well. It really just depends on what they do to it, because that is another topic entirely, because I think it's very funny that everyone was freaking out about that. They're like, oh, this just needs to happen. It needs to happen. It needs to happen. And then they freaking finally announce it. And then everyone's like, wait a minute. What are they going to change? They're going to change stuff. And then they're freaking out about it again.
Yeah. People are never going to be happy.
Oh, yeah. Like you cannot please. Ugh. Anyway.
But, Do you not own it right now?
I do.
I'm surprised that you would want to wait. Let me just give you my perspective. I want to play it beforehand because I want to know if I even care about the remake. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, I have the original discs and everything. So I have it for PlayStation 1. For me, as I found with Chrono Trigger, which I put, you know, around a little over 30 hours into, the best thing for me with a game like that is for me to be able to take it with me. Like if I was playing that on Super Nintendo,
bro, get a PSP.
I know, exactly. And so if I do end up getting a Vita, I will be playing Final Fantasy VII. I will just, you know, download it from the store and
don't even get a Vita, man. Get an old school PSP. I got a PSP 3000. Man, those things are like cheap now.
Or that, yeah. So. I don't know. We'll see. If you really want to play
Final Fantasy VII, I'm just saying
yeah.
that is an option.
I'm not I do want to very badly, but I'm not in a hurry to, just because there's so many other things that I want to play. So, and you know, the thought of digging into another JRPG is daunting to me at the moment. So,
no, I understand that. Yeah.
Which I'm very glad I finally beat Chrono Trigger. That was very much so very pleasing to my body. But yeah. I need some, a couple 6 hour, 7 hour long games in my life now.
No, I totally understand that. So you were talking about Shattered Memories. I need to play through that game again, because that is... I want to talk about that game in depth with you. I feel like what we need to do is, like, some games we need to just, like, either dedicate an entire podcast to, or have, like, a separate thing where we just talk about a specific game.
We could do that. We could do, like, some kind of just... like review thing or something where we just,
because we've had Catherine on our podcast list.
I don't think,
like,
that's happening tonight.
Months
though.
Now, I don't think it's happening either. And we were going to talk about it today, but I think that, I mean, that especially that game. You and I both love that game, and I think it's one of those things that it deserves its own thing where we talk about it. I mean, it doesn't have to be long, but I think we should definitely give it its due.
Yeah, I need to play it a little bit again anyway before we talk about it.
Yeah.
Just because I know that's fresh on your mind, but I haven't really touched it.
Well, it's fading fast.
Yeah.
So many other things, but...
So many times I can just remember playing a game, and the only thing I remember about it is just the amount of times I wet my pants while playing it.
Yeah.
And that I just forget why I was wetting my pants.
Totally. That's absolutely true. That happens to me all the time. Was there anything else you wanted to talk about that you are playing currently?
What else am I playing? I mean, that's pretty much about it right now. I started playing that Rocket Robot game that I got for N64 a couple weeks ago. Started playing that this past weekend. That's pretty cool. I'll probably talk about that. I've got to get some kind of recording device so I can document the stuff that I'm doing. But yeah, that's pretty cool. I'll probably talk about that and order more tires or something. But
sweet.
But yeah, that's about it on my end.
Awesome.
I completely forgot Shovel Knight. So.
Oh yeah.
I got the physical version of Shovel Knight.
The legit version?
The legit version, which they went all out with this thing. Like, they have... It is a thick manual. Not like a Shining Force 3 manual, but, you know, a pretty thick manual. And you can just tell sometimes when you see something that it was just a labor of love. And they really loved what they were doing with this. And, I mean, it's Shovel Knight. But I'm actually playing through it with the Plague Knight, which was a DLC that came out a little while ago, and it's a completely different game. Like, you do a lot of the same things. The story's different. It's tailored towards the Plague Knight, but the mechanics are just completely different. And so even though you've played these same levels, well, most of the same levels and stuff like that, everything's played completely different. So it's a complete different angle looking at the game, which is cool, but it's still Shovel Knight. It has incredible music. That in and of itself needs its own review segment, video thinger discussion that we've talked about. It's $25, which is interesting. I read about this. It was originally going to be $20, and the game is being sold in stores like Walmart and Target and that kind of stuff. And they actually had to raise the price to $25 so that it did not immediately go into the bargain bin. Because apparently Walmart has some kind of policy where if it's like a $20 game, they have like literally a bargain bin that those games go into.
Oh my goodness.
And so it would have just directly gone in there. So they're like, we're going to have to.
Yeah, but I mean, I understand that. I understand wanting to get it on the quote unquote real shelf or whatever. Yeah. But then again, think about how many people digging through the bargain bin would be like, Shovel Knight. This looks pretty cool. And then just like get it and like, man, this is awesome.
Yeah.
Although I guess a lot of people, if you're into gaming, you know what Shovel Knight is.
Yeah.
Likely.
Yeah, that game is just so well designed. I just don't even...
tell you another indie game that you need to play, and it's not on the same scale as Shovel Knight, but it's all, but it is a really good indie game, is VVVVVV.
I have that for my 3DS, and I've probably played maybe like an hour of it or something like that.
Yeah. You need to beat it.
Yeah, that's a really good one. Actually, yeah. This is a good time to bring this up, which I can talk about it quickly because we're over an hour now.
amazing.
So I subscribe to this thing called IndieBox. Have you heard of this?
Yeah.
So IndieBox, for those of you who don't know, it is this one of those like kind of loot crate kind of box deals that you like a subscription box where once a month you get some kind of box and it has a bunch of junk in it, or not junk, cool things for nerdy people. And so what IndieBox is they take they feature an indie game once a month and they develop a box for it, like a physical box, and then they have like a quote physical release kind of form of it, where it's basically like one of those USB drives that has it's shaped like a card and then has a little flip out dinger that you put in the computer. That sounded really wrong. but it has, you know, like the artwork on that, and then it has some additional stuff that may come with it, like some in the past have come with like USB Super Nintendo controllers and like figures and just, you know, stuff like that. So this past month was Axiom Verge. Have you heard of that game?
No.
It is kind of a Metroidvania kind of style game, which I actually have it for PS4. Funny enough, I actually won it. The developers tweeted about the game, and you know, it was one of those, oh, first person to use this code, I get this game. And I was like, all right, I'm going to try this. And so, you know, I log in and I'm fumbling around trying to get this code entered. And by the time I entered, I was like, surely somebody has taken this by now. But
yeah,
nope, I got it.
That's awesome.
So, yeah. And the one of the cool things about the IndieBox is they actually it comes with a Steam code. That's on a sticker that's on the outside of the box. So if you, for whatever reason, want to collect this and never open it and just have it sealed, then you still have the game. So essentially it comes with two copies of the game.
That's awesome.
So, Jables, if you would like, you may have my code for this since I already actually own the game, but it's a pretty fantastic, pretty fantastic little game. It feels like a Super Metroid.
That's awesome. I love that game.
Yeah, and it's a really cool environment. The music's pretty cool. Kind of ambient, but, you know, kind of groovy at the same time. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love that kind of stuff, too. Man, that's awesome. I thought for a second you were going to tell me that you got a box version of VVVVVV, and I'm like, dude, I will pay you money for that.
I don't know. They might do that at some point.
Next, I don't know why I like that game so much. I think it's just the music is awesome. And it's a real fun game.
The music's good and the mechanics are really cool. Actually, this month's game is Freedom Planet. Have you seen this?
No.
So Freedom Planet is basically a Sonic clone. So it's, you know, it's a fast platformer where some dudes running around. So I'm looking forward to that.
Gotta go fast.
Yeah, gotta go fast. Actually played the demo on Wii U. So that'll be cool.
Sweet.
So IndieBox. That's a thing.
Man, we gotta figure out how to get on a stream together, like on Twitch or something, so that we can either play through something together, or, you know, one of us play and us just like comment together.
Definitely. That definitely needs to happen.
Because I was just thinking, I want to play through Bayonetta again before I play Bayonetta 2.
Uh-huh.
But I don't want to, like, you know, separate it out into separate videos for YouTube, and, you know, streaming's the natural, you know, second choice there.
Yeah.
And so I was thinking, you know, it'd be cool that if we were doing that together, not necessarily through the whole game, but at least, you know, some parts of it. So
yeah.
Maybe we should do that one of these days.
I support this.
Awesome.
maybe if we like aim to do that at least once a month or something.
Yeah, yeah, that would be pretty sweet. All right, well, I know we've gone over our time on the podcast tonight. This was really funny. We were like, you know, what are we going to talk about all these things? We have a topic on here that we were like, I don't know if we have much to say about that. And I'm like, well, let's just wing it. And of course, we don't even get to the second topic.
Yeah, we talked about the first topic the entire time.
Which is okay. I mean, that's fine, because I like going into the kind of detail that we do. So, awesome. Do you have anything else, Mr. Hammer K, that you would like to talk about before we wrap this up?
Negatory. That is about all I got for this evening.
Awesome.
Or morning, whenever you listen to this.
This random time of day that you are consuming said audio-ness.
Yes, this time of day of the week.
Exactly. Yes. So, thanks so much, guys, for listening to us ramble on here about the games we're playing. We hope you enjoyed it. Well, it's a band news, but
yeah.
We hope you enjoyed it. We are a band, by the way, Order of Tear. You can check out our music at videogamemetal.com or soundcloud.com/videogamemetal. We are also on the social media platform of your choice, probably, unless that platform is Pinterest. We're not there yet.
Keyword there.
We are on twitter.com/orderoftier, facebook.com/orderoftier, youtube.com/orderoftier, and vine.co/orderoftier, and instagram.com/orderoftier. And I think I hit them all that time.
Yes.
For the first time ever.
That was it. That was very impressive.
So check us out. We appreciate you guys listening to you. And listening to you? What? We appreciate you guys listening to us. Man, it is obviously time to wrap this up. So
yes.
Thanks, guys. We will do another one of these guys in 2 weeks. Check us out next Monday. The 9 plus 7 is 16. The 16th of November, we're going to be doing a hangout on air, and we'll schedule that on our YouTube channel. Come hang out. Ask us questions. You can tweet to us. Use hashtag talk to tier, and we will include the things that you tweeted us in our podcast, however random they may be.
Precisely.
So, thanks again, and until next time, that guy over there is Mike the Hammer K. Kludzinski. I am the Game Mage, and we'll see you next time.
Goodbye, Internet.
Peace out. Did I really just say peace out?